It's Thursday night, and that can mean only one thing. You're tuned, you're basically glued to your screen because it is STC time, the Sim Racing Team Challenge on PSR TV, brought to you by GameHosters.net. This is Eckhard von Glan, your friendly voice from the north of Germany speaking, and hello and welcome to everyone. Welcome, first of all, to Andreas Hultgren, who's with me tonight as a co-commentator. Hi, Andreas.
Hello, everyone.
And welcome also to José Estrada, the man who pushes all the right buttons at all the right time. Hi, José.
Hello, Eckhart, and hello, everybody.
And David Garcia is out on the in the safety car, our green safety car, just trying to get it around Spa-Francorchamps, because that's where we are tonight in Belgium for the grand season finale, for the final 10th and last race of this year's season, and oh my god, it is so close, you won't believe it. Let's have a quick look at the overall standings before the race tonight. And there we have it. It's Gameracer FlatOut Racing sitting in number one, the defending champions for the first time this season. They are, in fact, in number one. But just 2 points away from Roaring Pipes Maniacs, who were the winner 5 seasons ago and who desperately, desperately want to have the title back. Then we have a bit of a gap to the old guys from Sweden, the Gup Klubben players there, rounding up 333 points for position number three. Sounds a bit like magic, doesn't it? And Andreas, you know any of these guys personally, the Gup Klubben guys?
No, I don't.
They're not exactly your age, aren't they?
Well, actually, I don't think everybody is 50 plus, but some of them might be.
Yeah, that's what the name says. That's what the name says, isn't it? Anyway, we have the Flying Dutchman in four, followed with another sizable gap by the Flying Canadians, who didn't show up for the last game, for the last race at Le Mans. And then it's the Black Rebels, your team, Andreas, in six.
Yay.
And you have another great Swede tonight on the grid. We'll come to him later on, Mikael Hellen, who set up a pretty good qualification time for your team. So maybe some points for you tonight, some more than in the season so far.
Hopefully.
The team on your track, or hot on your heels, is Course Online from Italy, and they set in some brilliant, or put in some brilliant qualification results, so you'll be hard-pressed. Then, bit of a gap to Gameracer FlatOut Club, the junior team of the champions, in 8. In position number 9, new team this season, Waterblue Racing, finishing off their first quite successful season of STC Racing. In position number 10, the comeback team, Torrent Motorsports, who did a full season this time, who were with us a couple of races before. Then it's my team, basically we are the last, don't let that table here fool you, Blue Flag Racing, down in 11, and we're only fielding one player tonight, other guy is missing in action, so Theo de Bruin, all alone, Theo, keep going. And then Sonic Racing, who joined us for last race at Le Mans from Portugal, they're of course last because they didn't really have a chance to score many points at all. Well then, that's the standings so far. How much time to go before the start, Andreas?
Just over 3 minutes.
Just over 3 minutes, so let me put you a bit in the picture as for the points. Already, Gameracer FlatOut have taken one more point for the fastest qualification lap, which was done with a gap of about a second by Mr. Mike Simian, who really burned the track here at Spa-Francorchamps with a time of 2:11.932, whereas the second best time was 2:12.834. Now that is what I call a huge, huge gap, almost a second. So that brings them 1 point, so they are now 3 points away from the Roaring Pipes Maniacs. Winner in this race gets 32 points, second position gets 29 points, third placed gets 26 points, and then fourth placed 23 points, and then from there 22, 21, 20, and so on, to the very last. As it stands now, with Mike Simian on pole and Kevin Clark in position number 5, the FlatOuts would get 32 and 22, that is 54 plus the one for the qualification, 55 points, whereas the Roaring Pipes Maniacs, who find themselves in positions number 6 and 8 respectively, would only get 21 and 19 points, so 40 points. That would mean if we were to red flag the race right now, the Game Racer FlatOut would gain 15 points advantage over the Roaring Pipes Maniacs and would secure the title. Which means, Andreas, as the race begins, they do have a bit of an advantage, don't they?
Yeah, they do. And well, we saw last time at Le Mans that the RPM guys, they know how to overtake and close the gap pretty quickly.
Yeah.
But it's a different track, and I'm not really sure about the weather, but I think it's going to be sunny, right?
Yes,
that's what the forecast says.
Yeah, so it might be a bit more difficult to gain that much in the early stages of the race.
Yes, I'm really flabbergasted by the results, 6 and 8. I mean, we were expecting like a 1, 2, 3, 4 by the two leading teams, weren't we?
Yeah, and well, it's going to be interesting as well with the course online drivers up there in the mix, what they can do, and of course Ben Tusting, race winner this season for FlatOut Club. He's starting in second, so a lot can happen.
Yeah, it brings up also the issue of the junior teams, because it is, well, not really an unfair advantage, but it can play to the Game Racer FlatOut Club's advantage, can't it?
Yeah, definitely.
Yes, but what we all expect is the race independently. I mean, that there will be team orders between them. It's what everybody expects, and I think the FlatOut guys, prefer to lose the championship fair and square than win it because of team order. I think so, at least.
Well, doesn't quite match with the season finale, the final race at Hamilton last season, because they ordered the FlatOut Junior racer into the pits, if I remember correctly. Hit me on the forum if I'm wrong, but I think he went into the pits with about 4 or 5 laps to go, and it wasn't needed in the final result because they were champions anyway. But just to be on the safe side, I think they did it. So, and who are we to blame? I mean, it's one team basically, and it's a bit like Red Bull and Toro Rosso in the Formula One, isn't it?
Yep. I agree.
Well, there we are then. Grid is assembling on the grid as usual, and that was about the dumbest sentence of the evening, I'm sure. Anyway, Jose, where's our camera?
Okay, we are just going to the grid now.
All right. In the opening lap, while David takes the field round the track, I suppose we start at the back again and then show people where their players ended up in the qualification, because that, I think, gives us a nice view of the whole field.
Yes, I think not all the cars joined the grid, right? As I can still see Tyler in the pits. So
last guy on the grid should be David Clark. according to what I wrote down here. Well, what do you all expect? First corner, will we have a melee with the Roaring Pipes guys trying to push the envelope as early as possible, or will we have a nice, safe and secure turn one?
Hopefully a safe and secure one. Tricky as well in Eua Rouge on the first lap, a lot of cars,
yep.
And
yep.
Chain reactions can happen and stuff like that, but hopefully we will have a clean start.
Yep, Eau Rouge is really going to be a place to watch very, very, very closely indeed on the first lap. And so I can see David Garcia now edging forward very, very slowly in the safety car. And that means that we're about to start the race any moment now. It's the big season finals here at Spa-Francorchamps STC season 2011. Part number one is coming to an end, and there they go, setting off. And let's see if they all get away cleanly here. So then, we have our rundown of the positions here on the grid. It's position number 23 for Tyler Skerlock for the Flying Canadian Racing. He is a very, very fast guy indeed, and finds himself at the back of the grid. I think must be either a technical issue or something to do with the rules. Bit out of my water here. And Michael van Schepingen in 22 for the Flying Dutchman Racing. So that's the sister team there of the Canadians. Then Reggie Blaine in position number 21 for Torrent Motorsports. Now all these three, if I watch this correctly on my screen, didn't set a qualification lap, which I think means they all crashed out at one point or another, or they had a technical issue to deal with. But anyway, they're on the grid, so that's the good news here. For their teams, Reggie Blaine in 21. Then in 20, it's the first of the new Sonic Racing players, Ricardo Silva from Portugal, bearing the number 13. In 19, the lonely blue flagger on the grid tonight, Theo De Bruyne, in the orange version of our Doran, taking the Doran through this for one last time. Then Paolo Honorato, we're very honored to have you with us tonight, Monsieur or Mr. Honorato, in 18. 17 for Kelvin Fande of the Flying Canadian Racing Team. Brings us to 16, Eric Twaite for the Team Waterblue Racing. And he follows his teammate Iha Bus in 15. That leads us to 14, Ethan Bass, Torrent Motorsports, and then Andreas, your first of your two teammates, Ben Buitendijk in 13, a long, long Dutchman. And there we have it, Daniel Beck, first of the good ones in the top dozen, number 12, I must hurry up a little, 11, Hugo Heckenberg for the Flying German Racing. In position number 10, Bosse Jonasson, second of the Gubklubben's guys. In position 9, but of course that's position 8, sorry guys, because we have that in front. Position 8, Marcin Skrzypczak of the Roaring Pipes Maniacs. Position 7, as mentioned earlier, Michael Hellen for the Black Rebels. Position 6, Hannu Karesola for the Roaring Pipes Maniacs. Position 5, Kevin Clark for Gameracer FlatOut. Position 4, Luca Dafara of the Course Online. Position 3, Marco Giuliato for the Course Online. Position 2, Ben Tusting for Gameracer FlatOut Club. And position number 1, it is, of course, Mike Simian. And the race is open, and here they go. It's the first turn. They go into the first turn now, and Tusting already attacking Mike Simian there. That looks a bit like a move that these guys maybe talked a bit before, but nothing comes out of it. He stays, Simian stays in front, and Tusting stays in two. They have the two Course Online players behind them. It's Eau Rouge for the first time. The top players are through. Tusting there, almost slipping out, but they remain safe and so. We had a very, very safe first few turns, Andreas.
Yeah, well, yes and no. No major drama, but I think that Theo de Bruyne had some problems in turn number one. He might have got a hit from behind or something. There were a lot of smoke and he's dead lost. Well, no, Tyler Skerlock is dead lost, but he's second to lost.
Okay. I didn't see that on my screen, but that's why we have two commentators here to give you a more rounded image, more rounded view. It's Mike Simian still leading the pack here as they go down towards Lacombe for the first time. Sorry, they're into double gauche now. Sorry, mixed up the turns here for a moment. And again, we see Tusting moving to the outside of the track quite a lot. And it's a nice up and down hilly kind of track here in the Ardennes Mountains in Belgium. And I don't think there's a single player out there who doesn't like the track. Andreas, you like it?
I love it.
Yep, a little trivia quiz for you. Who set the fastest time ever on this track in 2002?
Well, I guess it's Formula One.
Yep.
2002? Maybe Montoya, I don't know.
No, Michael Schumacher.
Ah.
Schumacher did 143.7, so that is really fast.
Not a big surprise then.
I was thinking
that it was somebody else.
Anyway, lap number one, almost done, and we have Simian leading, and we have Ben Tusting in two, and we have the two Course Online players in three and four, and so far, not much of a move done by the RPM players, but they've got past Michael Hellen, and the first of the RPM players, touched there by one of the RPM players, that is Hannu Karesola. A little tussle there with Kevin Clark of the Gameracer FlatOut and Chaussee. We should move to positions 6, 7 and 8 if we're not there already. Sorry, 5, 6 and 7. Because that is where the action is. We can see both of the RPM guys, both of the Roaring Pipes Maniacs guys, in the slipstream of that one Gameracer FlatOut car by Kevin Clark. And Karesola now moving out of the slipstream, actually letting Skrzypczak pass, so that obviously again was team order with Skrzypczak, possibly on TeamSpeak saying, listen Hannu, I've got the speed, let me try to move past.
A bit interesting, Kevin Clark was right on the tails of Luca Tafara, and as soon as the RPM guys showed up right behind him, he dropped off the pace and went into defense mode right away.
Okay, so this is what we call the moving shield.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, I actually like that aspect of team tactics rather. I really like it.
Yes, because he probably knows that if the two RPM guys pass him, they will probably be able to attack at least the two Course Online cars, and then the championship will be in danger. If he can keep them behind him, there will be a different story.
Yes, and look at how the three of them actually now close the gap to the Course Online players, because being under pressure that much, he really has to move faster.
They are catching the Tafara again.
Yep, they are. And we may see an attack here by Kevin Clark as they move into the last turn. That's where Vettel hit button, not this season, but last season. Everything's safe and sound here. Skrzypczak is still following Clark very, very closely. I wonder if we see something now in T1. And further down the grid, it's the two Gubkloven guys have passed Michael Hellen. That's just what I saw there in the back. And very close racing here as they go through Las Sures.
Karesola has been off the track a little bit a couple of times the last half a lap.
Yep.
So he's pushing really, really hard.
Yep.
And what's the gap now? I think David is with us now.
David? He is, and here we see the attack. Sorry to interrupt. Here we see the attack. The first course online player is now being targeted by Mr. Clark, and a little touch there. Clark trying to push through, but I think it's Dafara trying to defend his position. And Marcin wisely not moving in too close there. But now he's trying to make up on lost ground. Dafara it is. Dafara defending now against Skrzypczak and against Karesola, while Clark seems to be able to slip away just a little. And now Skrzypczak desperately, desperately trying to get past, but there's no way you can get past there. If he gets a good exit now, after... Oh, there he goes! There he goes on the inside. Dafara running just a little wide, and Skrzypczak gets through. Dafara now defending against Karesola for all it's worth, and Karesola has to be very careful indeed to not crash into the course online player. But all of this costs him a lot of time. And Jose, I think you were asking about the time gap to Mike Simian at this point.
Exactly, yes, to the P1.
From Skrzypczak, it's 6 seconds.
Oh, it's not much.
Nope. And we now see Karesola behind Dafara, and we will definitely see an attack as they head into the last chicane. And out they go, both of them, onto the tarmac there, and now Karesola will move out onto the right-hand side. No, he won't. No, he won't. He stays behind while both Clark and Skrzypczak have slightly overshot their breaking point. And Karesola has to play it safe here for the time being, while they had into La Source for the third time.
And I was asking before about David. I think he has to be with us now.
Yes.
Hello. Sorry, guys. David, we didn't give you any any chance to speak your mind.
I know.
Safe and sound outlap that you had with all the players, everything fine?
Yeah, one of the best we have seen in the season, Eckhart.
I think it shows everybody is really spot on tonight, really wanting to have a good result here and a clean race tonight. And we see a highly interesting race here because it's the Roaring Pipes Maniacs trying to catch up. What's your theory? Why were they so slow in the qualifying?
Well, I really don't know. Maybe they were not that slow, but we have other actors in the guest role, and these are the Italian guys, the Corse Online Racing. Maybe they are deciding the championship tonight.
It could be.
Well, Luca Lafara went long in a corner, and now Hugo overtook him.
Hannu Karesola.
Hannu.
And we have the first player leaving the game. It's Eric Twait, I'm afraid to say, for Waterloo Racing out of the... Was that the player who was a bit down before, Andreas?
Not sure, but the problem he suffered was on the long straight, on the camel straight.
Okay.
So probably a disconnection, I think.
All right. And do you see, like I do, smoke coming from the car of Marcin Skrzypczak?
No, it must have been tire smoke, I think.
Okay, let's watch this for a moment, because I think it was on a straight, but I'm not quite sure. And these Doran engines, they do tend to blow up from time to time. And there it is again. Not a good sign indeed for the Maniacs. There is some smoke coming from the exhausts of Marcin Skrzypczak's Doran, and let's hope that everything is fine there.
Well, that would be like Formula One drama with an engine failure.
Yep, it certainly would. And the big fight now is Marco Giuliato for the course online trying to defend his position against Kelvin Clark. But here we have Kelvin Clark on the very, very long camel straight, edging past, but Giuliano trying to make a move on the inside. Ooh, that's going to be close.
Dangerous.
Dangerous, dangerous. Ooh. And he just manages to not spin out there, but that gives Karesola some space. And you're right, guys, it's actually the tires producing such a lot of smoke as these people go into the turns. Any idea why that is so? I've never seen it before.
I think Simbin included some new smoke effects or something in the latest patch.
Ah, that would explain it. Yes, definitely. I think I read about that too. So, Skrzypczak fans, breathe easy. It was just smoke from the tires, but there is a lot of smoke coming. I actually find this quite unrealistic. Lots and lots of white smoke coming from the tires if you put stress on them in the corners, obviously.
Well, we know if they look up and not.
Yep.
It's a little bit too much, I think, but anyway, it's what it is.
Yes. Yes, the joys of sim racing. So, Giuliato defending for all it's worth now against Skrzypczak out on the grass there. I hope he can get enough speed, yes, again. Out onto this other long, long straight blanchiment, which is not basically, it's a combination of three turns, isn't it? But it feels like a straight, really. That's the only one, the last one, where you actually feel it. And then now Skrzypczak choosing.
Here it comes.
Extremely late break. Ooh, it's the Vettel button incident all over again. And there he rejoins the track, or trying to rejoin the track, but Skrzypczak is past. That was, well, a move. Let's just call it a move for the time being.
It looked as though both went for the same piece of tarmac.
Yep, definitely. And there was only one player, room for one of them on that specific piece of tarmac. So, the fights at the top have settled a little. We have Mike Simian still leading the race. We have Ben Tusting still in number two. And then we have Kevin Clark in three. And we have Marcin Skrzypczak in four.
Yeah, I wonder what happened to Bossy Jonasson. He was on, I think, P9, behind Daniel Beck from his team, and now he's far behind.
Ah, he has damage on the front.
Yeah.
So, just a quick rundown then. I gave you the top positions. In 6, it's Hannu Karesola. In 7, Luca Tafara. And then the first really big gap of the field opening to Daniel Beck. And as my two friends here were just saying, they were together, the two Gubklubbens, before. And now we have Bosse Jonasson missing. There must have been some incident. It could only have involved the teammate, could it? Because they were so close together.
Possibly.
That would have been awfully bad luck.
Yeah.
Anyway, and I really must get used to that smoke. It is annoying the hell out of me. Anyway, here's Mikael Hamel in position number 9 and having his own battle here, defending that good position for the Red Rebels against two players. That's Hugo Heckenberg for the Flying Dutchman Racing and Kelvin van der Linde for the Flying Canadian Racing. And from the sound of it, they both Dutchmen. Just one of them running for the Canadian outfit, if I get this right. And but Mikael seems all set and ready to defend his position here. It looks as if all three of them are running pretty much the same speed here around the track. And now we see a little move by Hugo, but and it does what it should have done. It unsettles Mikael a little, but he can regain his speed. Let's see if Ben Buitendijk, another Dutchman, can actually catch up to this trio here as they are struggling. Yes, he can. He's definitely getting closer. So it's going to be a four-way fight a little bit further down the line.
Yeah, he was actually in this group before. And maybe he was the one coming together a little bit with Jonas.
Talking of come together, big one here by Hugo Heckenberg off the track, and he rejoins, and ooh, thank goodness. Let's be happy this is only sim racing and not the real thing. It would have been a mighty and awful crash there. Takes away some of the pressure from Michael Hellen. And Andreas, are you still with Hugo Heckenberg? Is he able to rejoin the race?
He is trying. I'm not sure if... Well, I have never seen a dented Doran like this before. No rear wing and dents all over the car.
Oh dear, he's trying to finish that one lap, but it's a whole lap now. That's going to take him ages.
And he has problems with his rear wheels, probably puncture and possibly suspension damage. There must be a lot of suspension damage.
There must be, yes. The small taps I've got suspension damage for, this must be completely wrecked. And this is sad news for the Flying Dutchman, very sad news indeed. I think he slightly miscalculated the exit of Eau Rouge, didn't he?
Yeah, he tapped the inside wall and he must be really careful now, going back to the pits with no rear wing.
Yeah.
I just get news from my cameraman that the smoke Andreas and I keep complaining about is actually not to be seen on your screen, because don't know why, but there you are, the magics of sim racing. And now we see back very clearly, however, Kelvin van der Linde making a move finally on Michael Hellen and edging, just squeezing past the Nasurs. Very, very careful and very well-adjusted move there by Kelvin. Very well done indeed. Bad news for Michael, who's down to 10. And Kelvin van der Linde up to position number 9. Let's have a rundown then. Position number 10, Michael Hellen. And position number 11 now, Ben Buitendijk, who very nearly overtakes his teammate here at the end of Kemmel. And then in position 12, Bosse Jonasson with that dented front. And obviously he can't really follow the pace of the others in front. And he has some serious problems with the handling of that Doran. Then in position number 13, Ihab Abbas. About to put in a big, great performance, great show here for the Waterblue Racing team. He used to be with Amy Racing last season, and he is with Waterblue now, and I don't think it was a bad choice to do, because he's showing some good speed.
Yes, more drama for the Flying Dutchman Racing crew.
Oh dear.
Michael van Scheppingen just went straight over Lacombe, and when trying to rejoin, he spun around a little bit and hit the wall. Not very hard, but he lost down to 18th. And a lot of time.
Oh, that is indeed drama. And we see huge drama here, position number 14, 15 and 16. It's
Guys.
Another of the Flying Canadian Racing. Yes, David?
Hugo Heckenberg is at pit, ready with a new rear wing.
Okay. So he's going to be lapped, so we have to be really careful for a Flying Dutchman racing car that is a lap down. Talking of flying, it's a Flying Canadian racer, Tyler Skerlock, who started from the back of the grid, remember, position number 21. And he's up in 14 already, so he already gained 7 positions, so that's good news for the Flying team. Among all the bad news about the Flying Dutchman. And he just squeezed past Ricardo Silva, who is up in 15, which in turn means he must have had a very good start, because he was in 19 on the grid. So Silva putting in a great performance here for Sonic Racing in 15. And followed... And more drama. Andreas, what's just happened? You just told us on the whisper, but tell everyone.
Yeah, I was going through the field a little bit to check the front guys again, and Marco Giuliato, he is defending hard from Hannu Karesola, but he's defending too hard as his engine is about to give up. There is smoke everywhere.
And this is not the first time, Andreas, because when we had the Hugo Heckenberg crash, I just was saying whoa as well, but it was because I saw a lot of smoke coming out from Marco Giuliato's engine. So I thought his engine was blowing up already, but looks like he's blowing up the engine step by bit.
And just to make sure, it doesn't seem to be the tire smoke that me and Eckhard was talking about before.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And I would it used to happen when your radiator is too closed, it can start smoking, but you can save your engine anyway.
Yeah, he has to be careful.
Yeah.
He definitely has to be. And with Karesola on your back, you don't really want to be careful, do you?
No, but he's struggling a lot with the tires, it seems. Because he's sliding all over the place.
Yep, and Karesola is off just a little bit right now. So he does seem to have some small handling problems here at... but look at that smoke now coming out of Giuliano's
and
car.
It seems to be when he's on the throttle for a very long time, that's when it comes.
Yep.
Because it's on the camel straight and as well towards the Blanchimont.
Yep, definitely. So... there seems to be a problem once he reaches the really high revs in sixth gear. I wonder how long he can make it with an engine like that, though, and I wonder how much speed it actually costs. And in the back, we see almost another overtaking maneuver.
Yeah, that's Hugo, who's trying to gain some positions, I guess.
Sorry, that's Hugo Heckenberg. I told everyone to watch out for that left player, and now we have we really have smoke all over the place, Marco Giuliato, and it must be really difficult actually, but at this point to see anything at all for Hannu Karesola, and I think he's actually keeping kind of a little distance here to Giuliato, so as not. He does have problems. Karesola has serious problems with the handling of his Doran. He must have banged one piece or another of the equipment somewhere, because that is totally unlike Hannu Karesola. He is one of the cleanest players out there, and that was a very wild move indeed.
One thing about the circuit is that it's so fast, but it still has corners, and you always try to gain as much top speed as possible. And then, of course, you will suffer in the end in the corners. And,
yep.
Maybe he went a bit too aggressive on the low wing.
Yep, it's my perennial mistake that you actually gain more by having better exit speed, is it? Rather than going into the brake, going to the brake zone too late.
Yeah.
And it keeps, especially at Spa, that's one of my favorite mistakes, just braking too late, just trying to, you know, take as much speed as possible from the straight. But no, you should brake early and then accelerate out of the turn early. And there we have the smoke again. Huge big signal saying this Ford V8 is about to go.
Well, we haven't talked much about the leaders. Simian, of course, leading, but Tusting is only 2 seconds behind him, and he's keeping a fairly, constant distance to his sister team.
It really is kind of, I am the living barrier. And now Karesola is pitting. This is interesting. Yes. Karesola is in the pits. I was just trying to figure out where he went. I'm very happy he's still with us and didn't have to disconnect, but obviously there is something seriously wrong, or he is on a two-stop strategy, because it's rather early in the race, but that must be two-stopper, mustn't it?
Yeah, I don't think... Well, he might be putting the hard tires on, but I doubt it will last for 60 minutes.
Yep, especially at Spa.
Yeah, especially at Spa.
He's pitting out in position number 13.
Yeah, right in front of Tyler Skerlock.
And yeah, as you said, right in front of Hannu Karesola, right in front of Tyler, who now has the advantage of warm and nice grippy tires, so he should be able to make a move in one of the next two or three turns, because he is a superb player as well. So let's stay with this pair here for the time being, see how Hannu recovers, and see how if he still has that strange behavior of that car, which just went, going out of the turns, it was almost uncontrollable. Well, but Karesola has everything under control here, and that means, Jose, we've been stopped in our rundown two or three times already. Let's have a rather quick rundown from here so that the back markers also get their airtime, which they well deserve. It's difficult enough having your door in, but it's really difficult having your door in the last race of the season at Spa-Francorchamps.
Guys, let me tell you something before the roundup.
Yes, yes.
I think Hannu made a good decision going on pit, and I was about to say that if Marco Giuliato waits a bit to get into the pit, he will lose the position, but Marco Giuliato is at pit right now with Ben Tusting, with Mike Simian and Kevin Clark.
Oh, so they're all on a two-stopper.
Marcin as well.
Marcin as well, so that means two-stopper is the name of the game. Karesola really is very fast now, gaining on that good club and player there, now getting past. And yes, well then, here's our rundown. 11, Karesola. 12, Bosse Jonasson for the good club. 13, Tyler Skerlock, going into the pits as well. Everyone's into the pits now. It's a big bonanza there. 14, Reggie Blaine for the Torrent Motorsports. Obviously now advancing, so we should not move to any other player before these guys have moved through Eau Rouge, otherwise we'll move back to the pits again and again and again, and we see the first of the Gupfloven players already exiting here. So, Reggie Blaine now in 11 due to the pit stops, followed in 12 by Ihab Abbas. Ooh, and Ihab is just recovers there, and he's now overtaken by Daniel Beck of Gupkloben, so he's down to 13. Then in 14 and 15 we have both the Sonic players. It's Paolo Honorato in 14 for Sonic Racing, followed in 15 by Ricardo Silva, who has a slightly banged up Doran on the left hand side.
Guys, after the pit stop, looks like Marcin has lost a lot of time with respect to Kevin Clark.
Oh dear, we've seen this before. We've seen this before. The Roaring Pipes Maniacs sometimes have a little trouble in the pits. They really must work or speak to the pit crew in the summer break. Position number 16, Tyler Skerlock, but he's been to the pits already. So let's move to position number 17. And there we have Michael van Schepingen. So he may have run into trouble earlier on, but he's back on the track and back in the race, but he hasn't been to the pits yet, I suppose. In 18, Bosse Jonasson, he has pitted already.
Oh, guys, sorry for the interruption. Luca da Farra is in big trouble. He spun in the pit entrance. You know, it is really... Oh, God.
Oh, when he rolls.
Yeah.
Oh, dear, he flipped. He flipped the car.
Yeah, he got hit by Kelvin van der Linde.
Oh dear.
Yeah, I was about to say that when he entered the pit, he went in a bit too hard and nudged the wall a little bit, but he went continued after it, but then apparently he made another mistake.
Well, very difficult situation.
What a big disaster for the course online. They don't really have the best of luck here tonight. I'm in P17 still, and I should say, I hope the camera is still with me in P17. And in P18, it's still Michael van Schepingen, who had a bit of an off moment right now. In 19, Ethan Bass, haven't seen any of him tonight for the Torrent Motorsports, and all these players stay out, so they might be on a one-stop strategy. Ethan getting closer, actually, to Michael van Schepingen here. And van Schepingen maybe banged up his car a little. He went wide and into the wall just now. And so that might be Ethan's big chance to get closer. Let's follow these two through Eau Rouge and out into Kemmel, or onto Kemmel. Oh, and now they both go out. They both go out. Disaster here. Michael van Schepingen is out in Eau Rouge.
Position 17.
Michael van Schepingen did the same mistake that we saw earlier with Hugo Hagenberg. Seems to be a Flying Dutchman trouble tonight, problem tonight. And Ethan Bass then managed to slip past and managed to avoid Michael van Schepingen. Nearly went into the wall there as well. And Theo de Bruyne managed to overtake van Schepingen as well. So he's up to 16 now after watching the mayhem there. And van Schepingen is now very, very, very slow and obviously trying to get to the pits now.
Eckhart,
de Bruyne? It is, yes, please.
Not a lucky night for the flying men teams.
Not at all.
None of them.
Nope. And as we're watching, Theo de Bruyne is under heavy attack by Reggie Blaine of the Torrent Motorsports, and Blaine does a first-class maneuver here, and Theo de Bruyne is game, and lets him pass. Very well-executed move by Reggie Blaine. I'm really happy to catch that, because there is a lot of action going on in the STC, also in positions 15, 16, 17, but of course, season finale, we concentrate on the top positions. So
yeah, there's a big fight for P5.
Yes, we're going better in half a second. I know, Andreas, let me have my rundown.
Howdy.
Theo de Bruyne in 17, Michael van Schepingen in 18, Ricardo Silva now down to 19 and having some trouble, I would say, front left. Hugo Hagenberg in 20, still with a banged up car. And then 21, Luca da Fara seems to be out of the race in the pits. And that's it. So we're moving to P4, P5, I suppose.
P5, 6, and 7, because Marco Giuliato, a.k.a. Smokey, as we can call him now, he's in a big battle with Van Beidendijk and Hannu Karesola. And Beidendijk, he's obviously on a one-stopper, it seems.
But Marco Giuliato is like one of those planes that makes hearts and different paints in the sky with with all that smoke,
yep,
you know.
Yep.
Smoking a lot.
He is. He should be banned because there's a law in Belgium prohibiting smoking in public spaces. So Marco Giuliato shouldn't be on the track in a condition like this. But he is still very, very fast. Look at that. Right now he gained on Hannu Karesola and he gained on Ben Buitendijk. So,
yep.
It
seems like the TBR driver is suffering a little bit with worn tires because he's doing the one stopper.
Yep. And he's out now. Ooh. I hope he didn't catch Stuart's warning there. Marcin Skrzypczak, because that was quite far out of the turn there. But Karesola, I mean, in real life racing, he would have his windshield completely covered in oil by now. He would have a serious problem actually seeing the track.
Crash in the Rouge again. Marcin Skrzypczak is in the wall.
Yeah, out of the race.
Out of the race.
No,
he's trying to make it move again.
Yeah.
But serious crash.
And
by
here comes
Giuliato passing.
No rear wing for Marcin. No,
no
really bad
no,
luck for
not
RPM.
At all. Ooh, RPM. And Hannu Karesola, with a bleeding heart, will now move past his teammate. And guys, this is the end of the championship dreams for the Roaring Pipe Maniacs. I think we need a little wonder of Spa here for the Maniacs to recover, don't we?
Yeah, it looks like it. But it's still 50 minutes to go, so a lot can happen, but this is a big blow.
This is a serious, serious blow, because it means that the flat-out players can now really, really take it easy. And really can take the pressure out of the race. We might even see Ben Tusting moving past Mike Simian now, because Simian can go very slowly indeed now. What they need now is something like a position 2 and 5, or 2 and 7, or 3 and 4, whatever. It would still handle the championship, won't it?
Yeah, and Skrzypczak is actually going pretty fast without the rear wing.
He's losing
a lot of time, but he's pushing.
He would definitely still be able to pass me.
Probably me as well. But I mean, if he pits now and go for the hard tires, I mean, it will be a lengthy pit stop. But Ooh, we almost lose it again.
Oh, it's Richard Burns all over the place for Marcin Skrzypczak.
But if he managed to get the car repaired in a decent amount of time, then he went go for the hard tires, then he might actually be able to maybe bring home a top 10, top 15. If it doesn't hit the wall again.
He might have overdone it here. He's into the wall, and let's hope the Doran survives this crash. There's a certain point where even the Doran is unplayable.
Well, I don't think he can lose any more parts.
He's now got a flat on rear right. Sorry, rear left as well. But it's only two more turns to go.
And he's still in ninth position.
Oh, let's hope he can... he's missing the entrance to the pits. Oh, disaster, Marcin. He will get disqualified.
Yeah, he's going the wrong way, even if it's on the runoff.
Well, he's in a runoff.
Let's see, he is... But he's Mr. Lucky now, because he doesn't get a disqualify for that. He's still in the race, and maneuver lost him something like 3 or 4 additional positions.
Yep.
And he's very slow now going into the pits.
Yeah, enters the pits in 13th. Well, at the top it's Simian. And he has now a gap of 6 seconds to Ben Tusting. And then we have another flat-out driver inside, Kelvin Clark. He's a further three seconds behind.
Yes, the Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they really did their homework better. This time.
Big time. It's 7 and 8.
Made a perfect qualifying session. And they are doing great in the race, so...
They're fully in control. And they orchestrated the season perfectly, because they only gained the top spot in the second-to-last race at Le Mans last time, and now they're fully in control here.
And that is a bit surprising, to be honest, as they have 5 wins and RPM only have 1.
Yes, indeed. I was actually expecting the Maniacs to be able to take the title this season, but they have had their ups and downs, but it seems like tonight they've really had very, very bad luck indeed. But well, we have another 40 minutes to go.
Yeah, exactly.
There is still a lot of time to elapse before we can talk about final results. And at the moment, though, it looks as if Gameracer FlatOut can, at least they can put the champagne into the fridge at this point, I would say.
Anyway, remember, as you said, Eckhart, 48 minutes ago, if that happened to Marcin, which is usually very consistent and a non-doing mistakes driver, anything can happen to any guy in the field, including the flat-out guy. So
everything
can happen on 50 minutes.
Yep, I see your point, but on the other hand, let's not forget the pressure is off. The pressure really is off, and Mike Simian at this point, he will know what's been going on behind. And with the pressure out and with Theo de Bruyne out, no blue flagger on the grid anymore. Sorry to hear that, Theo. Hope it wasn't too bad. And with Theo de Bruyne out, that definitely is not going to take any pressure at all from Mike Simian. He doesn't really care about that a lot. But with the Roaring Pipes Maniacs in such a bad condition, I think that Mike can really take it easy now, which for Mike Simian still means he's going to be very, very, very fast, but I think he's going at 98% now.
A little update on Marcin Skrzypczak. He's in 16th, and he has about 15, maybe 14 seconds up to Ricardo Silva, who's in 15th.
Okay. He has a long way to go.
Yeah, and then it's a gap of like 10 to 20 seconds every driver.
Every player, yeah. Okay.
He's still on the lead lap, though.
All right, so he's still in the lead lap, so he hasn't been lapped.
Nope.
Okay, and just quick update for me, because I obviously... the top players, they were in the pits before, weren't they? So that was Marcin's second pit, and the moment the others pit for the second time, he's gonna gain a lot of time.
Yes.
The problem for Marcin is that he will need to handle the tires for a very long stint.
Yep. Possibly, there will be a lot of suspension damage to the Dorans, so this will be hard on the tires.
Yeah. By the way,
Spotter Hultgren tells me we move to P10. Yes, David.
Yeah, let's go to P10. Only wanted to mention the both Black Rebels cars didn't visit the pit yet, and they are position 6 and 8.
Yep, very good indeed, very good indeed. I wonder where you'll end up then later on in the overall final standings, but it looks as if they may be in a position to maybe do a podium. Might be close, but they might be in a position to do a podium. And one of them pitting now, David. I heard the pit siren going off in the background.
Yeah, Abbas, it's a pit. It's refueling the car. Engine stopped, so...
Yeah, big fight here for 10. It's Bosse Jonasson. Defending against Kelvin van der Linde. Down Camel they go and into Les Combes, as the combination here is called.
Guys.
And Kelvin is very close indeed. Yes, David.
Very bad news. Marcin, it's a pit again.
Marcin.
Marcin.
Well, very bad news for RPM.
For
FlatOut this.
Well. These are very bad news for everybody, as we were expecting a close fight for the championship.
Yep.
It was a stop-and-go penalty, I think.
Oh dear. That may be a result of his trying to lose as little time as possible with that totally banged-up door, and he was really all over the place, and he might have picked up one or two warnings there.
Yeah.
Yes, David, I agree with you, but I think that was already lost when Marcin lost the rear wing. It only makes it even more sure for FlatOut, as they just need one car finish in the race now.
And he will be last right now.
And very close here, Bosse Jonasson really has Kelvin van der Linde stuck like glue to his rear wing, and I suppose Mr. van der Linde is trying to move out on the right-hand side now, or not rejoining the slipstream at all. No, he isn't. It seems to be very difficult to take your speed out of that last turn. Another ouch there, David.
I think it was Michael van Scheppingen was hit the wall at Eua Rouge again.
Oh dear, and he's out of the race, so bad news, lots of bad news tonight, I'm afraid. This was going to be the very tense, very close season final race, and we have only bad news to tell you. And it's especially for people who live, not really close to the Spa-Francorchamps track,
scary move.
Look at that. That must have been the move of the race. Look at that, Kelvin van der Linde. We thought he was in the wall, but no, he managed to slip past.
It looked like he was going to lose the car and then gain speed doing it.
That was amazing. That was absolutely amazing. It's a pity we don't have action replay. We should have it from a different perspective.
Well, I think Bosse has changed underwears now.
I hear you. That was breathtaking move. Kelvin van der Linde, absolutely superb. And poor Bosse Jonasson, he must be scared stiff, because he saw his whole race damaged there, because obviously he suspected, oh my god, he's going off and I will be caught in the debris. And no, you weren't caught in the debris, you were caught high and dry and you were passed.
It looked like a movie, when you think the helicopter won't avoid the mountain, and then he appears.
Yep.
It
was similar like that, yes. So, Bosse Jonasson drops the position into 11, and it's a bit of A bit of a shame, really. But Kelvin van der Linde's superb move there puts him into position number 10.
Jonas's teammate Daniel Beck is actually soon in a fight himself, so maybe we should just move up a couple of positions to 6 and 7. He is gaining on Ben Biden, like, as they go through Eua Rouge, the corner of happenings.
Yep.
And Michael is pitting in now.
Yeah, Michael had him in the pits for his first one and only pit stop, so that's going to be really interesting to see where he gets out.
I guess we can expect the Biden Knight to pit soon as well then.
Yep. Well, you should be able to tell us you're in the same team.
Well,
we're lying.
They are aliens, I'm not.
We don't want anybody to know our real strategy.
No. The very.
It's a no stopper.
That's a no brainer. So guys, with about half the race to go, and with FlatOut fully in control of the proceedings here, and sorry FlatOut guys, you don't get very much airtime tonight because you're so much in control. And with Hannu Karesola feeling very, very, very lonely up there as the sole Roaring Pipes Maniacs player to be within sight of the race leaders, let's talk a little bit about the season that we had. Was it the kind of fight that you expected between the Roaring Pipes Maniacs and the FlatOut? Was this to be expected at the start of the season?
Yeah, I think so. Those were my two favorite teams for the championship. And of course, I thought Group Club and the Flying Dutchman could bring some competition to it. But surely those two were the teams to look at.
Yep. And why is it that both Group Club and Flying Dutchman, the other way around, what makes the Game Racer FlatOut and the Roaring Pipes Maniacs so dominant? And into the pits goes Ben Buitendijk.
I have the answer, Eckhart.
Yeah.
This is because the Black Rebels don't want to win all the championships, so we let them win some.
Ah, okay, yeah. Sounds like a very good answer.
Yeah. Five seasons
honest,
running.
Yeah. But honest, what is it that makes them? Is it the depth of the field that no matter what happens, they can still pick an alien from the hat?
Yeah, I think so, to be honest. Maybe it has a lot to do with practice. Maybe they do like 5,000 months of practice before every race. Because we have seen the winners from Gub Club, and we saw Robin Johansson taking a win this year.
Yes,
we
yes.
saw Marco Giulietto take a win last year at Interlagos.
Yep.
I mean, they are good drivers. They just... yeah. There
it's
are many good drivers.
Then, isn't it consistency?
Yeah. Well, this year for RPM it is. They won one race. But they are still in the fight for the championship, only 2 points going into this event. So it has a lot to do with the consistency as well as being at the front.
I think that really was the Roaring Pipes' biggest advantage this season, wasn't it? That they were always basically both cars in the top five, more or less.
Yeah. And if we look at last season, they won 5 races and Gameracer FlatOut Racing only won 3.
Okay.
They won more races then, but they still didn't win the championship.
yes, because in tennis we talk about the big points. And what do you think were the big points this season? What was, you know, the point where we could say, oh yes, that is why the Gameracer FlatOut are up there and that is why the Roaring Pipe Maniacs are up there?
Maybe we just have to look at this race.
I think
it's
so too,
very small margins.
It really is. That missed Eau Rouge by Marcin Skrzypczak really is like the biggest point that the Gameracer FlatOut could have won all season, isn't it?
Yeah, and don't remember, FlatOut did have some issues in the early parts of the season with a few cars that didn't finish.
Yep. For me, I think it was the qualifying in 2 races. In the last race, because they made an administrative mistake and they weren't able to qualify, so they were behind. Even with a fantastic race, they were behind the two flat-out cars at the end.
I agree.
And then in this race, they made a qualifying under what is normal for them. I mean, I never expected RPM to qualify like they did in this race, where they were fighting for the championship. And I think FlatOut really won the championship there before this race even started.
Yes, and then they also managed to stick to that position. I mean, it's one thing to get the top notch, but look at, for example, what happened to in real life racing, Formula One racing, Nico Hülkenberg, in that last race of last season. He was in pole, but couldn't hold on to the position. And these guys, well, they secure pole, and then they stick to the position, don't they?
Yes, because they also have the best, or one of the best paces of the race. It's not that they made the pole, but the race pace is also in the top three, probably.
Anyway, yep. And under my point of view, a part of the points you say, which are a lot, there is as well the point of other teams placing fast drivers where you should be. I mean, on tonight's race, Course Online placed his two drivers in front. Also, a flat-out club with Ben Tusting. And this can happen. Not all the races, but this can happen from time to time, because I think all the teams have at least one or two drivers with the capacity to qualify on top five. And this can change all your options and all your expectations on a
yep.
result.
Yes, but still, Mike Simian made the pole.
Yeah, Mike Simian without the two cars online and Ben Tusting behind him would have been very different race, in my opinion.
Definitely.
Both RPM would have been position three, position four, at least.
They had to push extra hard, and that really what made Marcin miss that one Eau Rouge there, which, as you said, is so unusual for him to do. And it was this aspect that they really had to push extra hard to make up on those positions number 6 and 8 that they had after qualification. And that might have been, as you said, they maybe, in fact, the big point was the qualification, that sitting in 1 and 3... the Gameracer FlatOut could really, well, they couldn't take it easy, but they had a huge advantage right from the outset, didn't they?
Yeah,
yes, sir.
Go, Jose.
Okay, Mike Simian is at pit now. What I was going to say is I agree with everything you say, David, but still with fast drivers in other teams and everything, FlatOut managed to do a 1-3 in qualifying with a big gap in time. I mean, I think the RPM guys were under their possibilities today.
Maybe, but remember, a 2-3 would be enough for RPM to win the championship. They didn't need to win the race, and the fact of having other teams fighting for the race, I think, is the point on tonight's race, at least.
Yep, it's the extra pressure.
I still think the time difference was too big.
Yeah, there's no way Mike Simian could. I mean, he can still lose the race. There's lots of things that can happen in the last 30 minutes. He's out of the pits now, in position number 3, actually, and Ben Tusting actually pitted behind him. But if everything is safe and sound, so if there's no mechanical failures, if there's nothing surprising happening, like we don't have any rain tonight and the weather is fine, which I actually like, because it really does present like a level playing field. And so it really is his game to lose, and he is showing extremely strong nerves here on this last race of the season. Right, well, speaking of last season, let's talk a little bit about next season, while Simian is possibly going to regain position number 1. And so let's talk a little bit about next season. David, what's going to come next season?
Well, a lot of things, Eckhart. A lot. We will change the cars. We will go possibly for the last season with the Race 07 series. We will go for the with the GT Pros. Some of them, not all of them, because we we decided some were really old models.
Yes, like the Lissa, for example.
Yeah, as an example. And we will change some things as well. Possibly the last teams on the standings will be the first team deciding.
Us. Yes, that will mean Blue Flag will be the first team to pick a car. Haha.
No, I think it will be Sonic Racing.
but yeah, we didn't say that we will use the GT Power Pack. So
yes.
Everybody will have to make the big investment of €4.99.
Yes, actually Simbin forced us to do that.
Yeah.
No, I think it's good to have the cars in the expansion pack and very cheap. I mean, if you have a computer and you have a wheel, you can pay €4.99.
Definitely. I totally see your point. And Mike Simian is now back in the lead while we're chatting away about next season. So it's going to be two from the Power Pack. That's the Ford GT40 and the Pagani Sonta. And then it's going to be a nice lineup of other GT Pro cars.
Guys.
And, yes, please, Andreas.
While we're at the subject of next season, Marco Giuliato's engine just gave up.
Oh, Smokey is out of the race.
On the run to Blanchimont.
Thank you for keeping us updated, Andreas. You seem to be the only guy who's actually really following the race very closely.
No, I'm listening to you guys too.
Well, we're chatting away here. But it's Simian in front, it's Tusting in two, it's Kevin Clark in three. So the flat-out players really have everything fully under control. While Hannu Karesola, poor, lonely Hannu Karesola, is doing the best he can. He's bringing home a lot of points, three of them. We at Blue Flag would be so happy to have 23 points out of one race. Anyway, he's bringing home 23 points, but it's not going to be enough either way. There's going to be, there needs to be a huge disaster in positions number 1, 2, and 3 for anything to change here. But at the moment, Karesola is the lone soldier for the Roaring Pipes Maniacs, soldiering on, doing the best he can. And Luca Tafara has left the game as well, so full-time disaster for Course Online here in the last game of the season. Oh dear.
Well, Luca Tafara was at pit for a long time since his
okay. So he decided that it was now time for the whole team to leave. Yep, Ben Wittendijk, by the way, after following his one pit stop strategy, is in position number 5, and he is about to be attacked by Tyler Skurlock in position number 6 for the Flying Canadian Racing. Remember, he came from 21 in the lineup from the very, very last position, and then that is obviously the race. The most positions won here tonight. And Daniel Beck is in 7 for Gubkluben, who lost his partner, a little Bosse Jonasson, a little earlier on. And they're now both approaching Ben Buitendijk, and they should both have a serious advantage tire-wise, shouldn't they?
Indeed.
So while they are approaching, poor Ben, David, tell us a little bit about the tracks that we're going to see next season. Is it going to be the same lineup that we have this season?
No, possibly we'll have one new track. Possibly we are working on it. An Aussie track, a street circuit, will be Adelaide with the...
Nice one.
Yeah, with the normal STC modifications, anti-curb, anti-cutting curbs, etc. And we will change some of the current schedule circuits. possibly Paul Ricard will be in again. Long Beach will be in. Maybe this will be the season with more street circuits, I got.
Ah, okay, okay. Yes, because they provide for some good close racing, don't they? Even though I must say I hate them because you have to be so extra careful and, well, I'm simply not good enough for that.
So, more or less, these are the news for next season. Car change, new circuits. We had a meeting, I can't, you know, with Andreas and José last week. And I would like everybody to know that we are taking care of all the safety car and safety conditions for next races. We want to have everything under control. And we are taking special care for all the change with Air Factor for the Blue Cup, the 2012 Air Factor
hopefully
is released before, yeah.
Yep, hopefully. And why
we didn't talking? We didn't mention. Sorry, Eckhart,
that.
We are probably going to test a new qualification system.
Oh yes,
but,
yes.
That's not sure.
No, but it's going to be something like Q1 and Q2, where only the top players will through the next round.
Yeah, exactly. But we have to test it because in the way we will do it, nobody did it with Race 07 until now.
Ah, okay. So that's going to be an August, obviously.
Yeah, normally the people use the practice session to do that, but then the grip changes and it's a bit more complicated. So, we'll try another way. Yes, we will need the help of the teams and the feedback from them.
Ben Buitendijk will definitely hate you for doing some small talk while he is defending the hell here against Gubkluben player Daniel Beck and Tyler Skurlock from the Flying Canadian Racing. And right now, I think he has lost his fight on losing tires, but they're going into Eau Rouge and Tyler, thank you very, very, very much indeed for not deciding to stick to your position there. It would have been chaos, but they're out onto Camel now. That's a huge fight, an impressive fight here. All three of them fully under control. Really impressive gameplay here by all three of them. Buitendijk now in the sandwich of the two players with fresher and obviously soft tires, whereas he is on pretty rundown hard tires. So he's really going to show all he can to defend his position number 6 against Tyler Skurlock. But let's see how that develops here. It's a fantastic fight, very, very close racing to finish off the season here at Spa-Francorchamps. And I think they're approaching Hugo Heckenberg, who is about to be lapped with that hugely banged up car.
Yeah, it could be.
And Skurlock now preparing a move on the outs. No, it's the wrong side. He decides to draw back another time. And but if he gets a nice exit out of Courbe Paul Frère. Ooh, and there goes there goes Hugo Heckenberg into the wall. Oh dear, oh dear. A very, very, very bad night indeed for the Flying Dutchman Racing. And now here we have Tyler Skurlock in the slipstream of Ben Buitendijk. And Daniel Beck has moved away a little. And now, Ben is really out and he's back. And Skurlock can't do anything. It seems to be extremely difficult to position your Doran approaching that brake zone where Vettel had his get-together with Button last season. Is that because you move differently into the runoff area, or why is it so difficult in that position? I mean, it's a long straight and it should be easy to get out of the slipstream there, shouldn't it?
Yeah, but the Valencia Street Circuit has a lot of long straights as well, but no passing, so sometimes there are mysteries.
Okay, that's the philosophical conclusion of the day. Thank you, Andreas. And now, I mean, if he doesn't pass now, what? But look at Buitenak, he's almost on the right-hand side there completely. That's what I call a defensive move. Well and done, Ben.
Maybe Skrzypczak is running a bit more downforce.
Yep, just maybe.
Because it looks like it.
Yeah, because I know that the PBR drivers have they gone for one, they're setting one, both in
oh
the front
dear.
And rear, I think.
Oh dear, so they were very close to just taking the wing off.
Yeah, pretty much. I know they experiment with it, and I think they actually run with it.
And I think Tyler is being demotivated for the you are not fast enough level in the rear of Ben's car.
Yes, definitely. And yes, you must be right. I think he's running on maybe two or three, because look at the way he's getting closer in the turns, and then they're out on the straight, and he really has no chance to move fast. And he is very close indeed here in the turns, and that's some superb racing by both of them to not even touch in these conditions. Oh, Skrzypczak now actually has to move out of the way. Here he goes. Nope, Ben is cutting in ever so gently in front, and now they're out onto the straight. But if he's in the slipstream, he really should be able to do
something. Oh, this is a dangerous place.
Oh, there he goes, Blanchimont on the inside, and he will be able to pull it off. Yes, indeed. If he can now, yes, he can. Brilliant yes. move by Tyler Skrzypczak. I've never seen anyone pass there in my whole life. Fantastic move by him, and we've seen another big move by another flying Canadian player earlier on. So, if there would be like a price
Kelvin.
For the most scariest move here, Kelvin van der Linde, what about him?
Yeah, almost a spun in the last chicane.
Ah, okay. And oh, look at the distance he puts between his Doran and Ben's in just two turns.
Yeah, let's see if he can claw the gap back on Daniel Beck.
Yep. He seems to be all set and ready to do so.
Oh well, Eckhart, you said Tyler's move was the hairiest in the race. I still think Kelvin van der Linde's was the hairiest.
Yes. I still think so. I was just going to say that they're both from the same team and they should get some sort of prize for doing, you know, the extra superb moves tonight.
Yeah, David, make sure they get an extra prize.
So 18 minutes to go, and time for a last rundown of the field, last rundown of the whole season, I would say. And the rundown, of course, starts at the man who has dominated, just completely and utterly dominated this last meeting of the STC in this Blue Cup 11 season. He's taken the pole with a lead of 0.9 seconds to second-positioned Ben Tusting, who is a very fast guy indeed. 0.9, that is, a disaster. Well, not for him, but for the rest of the field. Mike Simian, totally dominating the game here, totally dominating the last race of the season for STC Blue Cup 11 at Spa-Francorchamps. He's still leading the pack here. He's about to lap one of the Sonic players, and he is clearly set to gain the second title in a row for Gameracer FlatOut Club. Then in position number two, his trusted steward, Ben Tusting. Tusting, who's won a race earlier this season, so he has the stuff to win races, but not tonight. He's staying in position number two, and judging from the qualification time, he would have been hard put, even if they weren't in the same team, to attack Mike Simian tonight, because Mike is just so out of this world. Then in position number three, and this is very, very good news indeed for the Gameracer FlatOut Club. Sorry, for the Gameracer FlatOut Racing. It's Kevin Clark bringing home position number three for 26 more points. And they're really going to put a huge gap between the Gameracer FlatOut and the Roaring Pipes Maniacs, because it's only in position number 4 that we find Hannu Karesola. The sole surviving top-ranking player for the Roaring Pipes Maniacs, while in the back we see one of the Torrent Motorsports players having serious trouble, and we also just saw on our screen that Kelvin van der Linde, after making that stupefying move on one of the Gruppruben players earlier on, is out of the game as well. But it's Hannu Karesola in 4 here, taking home a lot of points for the Maniacs, but not enough to secure the title, which is very sad news for them, but very good news indeed for Gameracer. Position number 5, and he was in 9 before, so moving up the grid, Daniel Beck, but now under serious pressure. So let's stay with these two for the time being, because Tyler Skerlock, who started at the back of the grid in position, I think, number 21, has finally closed in on Daniel Beck here, and maybe about to make a move on position number 5. Still, it's Beck in 5 and Skerlock in 6, but judging from the speed that Skerlock has, this is not going to last very long.
Do you think he will make a move in the Eua Rouge?
I doubt that very much. Maybe he has Kelvin on TeamSpeak talking him through that move, but that would be the only chance.
He's in the slipstream now.
Yep, he is. And he's positioning the car, I think, for maximum exit speed. Yeah. Nope, maximum exit speed it is.
Ah, and there he's already side by side.
Oh, brilliant, brilliant. Let's call this doing half the van der Linde. That was half the move that Kelvin did. But it's enough to get past, I would say, as... Ah, oh, no! Ooh, Daniel, what a fantastic late breakpoint that was. He stays in front, and it really... it supports what you said earlier on, that the Flying Canadian Racing, they have a very high wing compared to the other teams, because he couldn't take advantage of that, even though he was already a bit past, I think, as they went out onto Kemmel.
Yep.
By the way, guys, you mentioned Kelvin van der Linde a little while ago. He was out of the race when you were doing the roundup.
Yep. Sad to say, because he made that extra special move, the move of the race earlier on, but seems like he ran into trouble and banged up the car one way or the other. Anyway, it's Daniel Beck still defending here like there's no tomorrow against Tyler Skerlock, but now they're out onto another straight, and let's see if he does Skerlock number 2, which would mean that he would have to move, start making the move now. Come on.
He tries
nope.
it.
He tries, yep. obviously someone warned Daniel on TeamSpeak that this is the place where Tyler decides to make a move, and now they're again approaching that last breakpoint. But again, no sign of anything here working.
Oh,
no, Daniel. Yes, Daniel's sliding, but he manages. And Kelvin had a mini dump, I just read on TeamSpeak. Thank you, Björn de Haas, for giving me that information. So that was very sensible indeed. So Kelvin had a mini dump, so didn't have any car problems there, but PC problems. Really sad to hear that, Flying Canadian Racing. But you still have Tyler Skerlock on the grid, and he's giving us a great, great performance here tonight. And now... this is crazy, this is crazy. But they managed to pull it off. They're just weird.
I don't know, maybe the grip in the endurance layout pit lane exit is better than in the track. So that's the reason why they go there.
Could be. So I think let's just simply continue with the rundown and then come back to them, because obviously this is going to take a little bit longer. So we have 5 Daniel Beck, 6 Tyler Skerlock, and then we'll see that many, many players have to leave the game here for various reasons. It's in 7, Ben Buitendijk. And Andreas, you can say his second name perfectly, because obviously you've been to Le Mans, the real Le Mans, together. So give us Ben's name in nice Dutch.
Ben Beidendijk. No, man, I have no idea.
Now you mess it up.
Yeah.
Ben Beidendijk. Beidendijk. So
Beidendijk.
Ben
yeah.
Beidendijk. Yes.
I think
Ben
it's
Beidendijk.
Like
yeah. I think it should mean beyond the dike, beyond the levee. But anyway, my Dutch is not that good. He's in 7. In 8, Bosse Jonasson. So he was in trouble early on, and he's obviously running with a banged front suspension because he's rather jerky, or the Doran behaves rather jerkily here. And he's followed by Mikael Hellen in 9, so the one-stopper paid off nicely for Team Black Rebels. Well done, good strategy. And then it's Marcin. Marcin, we haven't seen him for a long time, and he must have blisters all over his hands by now, because look at that Doran. It's a mess of a Doran, and it must be a handful in every single turn. But he is fighting, Marcin. He is showing a very strong fighting spirit here tonight at Spa, and he is in position number 10. And he dropped, I think, to 16, wasn't it?
I actually think it was in 17th. Oh, and Daniel Beck misses in Las Torres. But he manages to get the speed, so he's still in front.
Okay. You follow that while I do my rundown. Reggie Blaine in 11 for Torrent Motorsports. Great result there for Reggie. Well done, Reggie. In 12, Paolo Honorato for the Sonic Racing, bringing home that Doran again for the new Portuguese team here on the grid. And in 13, it's his teammate Ricardo Silva, so they're doing it team-wise here in 12 and 13. In 14, I think it's another big fight for Ihab Abbas for and an attack right now.
No, he's not.
That's a lap down. That's Michael van Schepingen a lap down, trying to unlap himself. Sorry there, Ihab Abbas. In 14, Ethan Bass, second of the Torrent Motorsports, still in the game. In 15, and then we have, not Michael van Schepingen, but Hugo Heckenberg. Last guy running in 16. Yes, that brings us to the end of the field. Yes, David.
Yeah, Marcin went at pit again for a stop and go.
Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear.
Yeah, I think so, because they were side by side through the double left-hander into Fanier, and now Skrzypczak has passed him into Stavelo.
Yep, he manages to squeeze past. And I hope it could be seen on your screens. I was back just in time after the rundown, and Daniel back after a long, long fight. I think he was fighting for 4 or 5 laps, and these are long laps, let me tell you, at Spa-Francorchamps. He has to let Titus Skrzypczak pass, and maybe he's trying to actually make a move now, because he's just basically trying to get his car under control. And with, I think, only 5 or so minutes to go, and we see another Torrent Motorsports car into the pits there. So that surely is another stop and go.
Maybe a splash and dash.
Could be. Yep.
If the Group 2 car can exit Eau Rouge close, I think with the more straight speed he has, can trade the pass, but now it's too far.
It's too far.
Guys, actually, Kevin Clark has caught Ben Tusting.
Has he?
P2.
So they're having a really nice Game Racer flat out 1-2 here to finish the season off, while the Game Racer flat out club drops to position number 3, but still has a superb result for the junior team.
Well, Tusting is still in second, but Clark is gaining on.
Okay. So I misunderstood you. I thought you had already gone past. But I tell you what, they're reserving that for the final finish straight.
Maybe they will do a 1-2-3.
Yep. They'll probably move side by side there. Let's see. How many more minutes to go? Yes, David.
Yes, about the Torrent Motorsports car on pit. It was Ethan Bass, and he was changing tires.
Oh, that's very, very unusual.
Yeah, so it's about 5 minutes to go.
Okie dokie.
No, 6 minutes, sorry.
So about 3 laps. 3 laps it is then. And Daniel Beck is losing bit by bit by bit. In every turn, I would say, Titus advances.
And Clark is now almost side by side with Tusting on the Kemmel Street.
Yep, they're really close now. Very, very close indeed. And we can still see Mike Simian in front, though, so they're really staying more or less close together within viewing distance of each other. And it just goes to show how much they actually control this very last. And it is, for the Maniacs, a very frustrating sight, isn't it? Because they were going into this race hoping to win the championship, and now they are really being shown a dominating Gameracer FlatOut performance here.
Well, to be honest, they won five races until now this year.
Yep.
This would
yep,
be
yep, yep,
the,
yep.
the sixth one. So,
six.
It was, yeah, exactly. It was like consistency against pure speed this year.
Oh, nice one. Yep. Sums it up very, very nice indeed. Andreas, make a note of that for the final report.
Absolutely.
And remember as well that Mike Simian made a very, very good race as well at Donington. So
yes.
It was a chance of having the same more or less on a Spa.
And as I said, a depth of field. I mean, it's Mikko Korkiakoski is out of the race because he has done five games already. They can't field him anymore. Well, no problem. We field Kevin Clark and he finishes in third.
Yeah,
or maybe
possibly,
second.
Possibly, now you mentioned that, José was right saying that RPM was not on his standards tonight. Even with the fast guys of Course Online and FlatOut Club on the top spots, I think José was right, because Marcin and Hannu used to be faster than what they showed tonight.
Yep. And yeah, again, may also... Sorry, go on.
No, I'm pretty surprised, because it's a track they know, and a car they know. So...
And I can't believe it, really, can it?
Yeah, exactly. They are much faster than what they showed today. But that is racing, of course. If you have a bad day
yes.
in a bad day, then you lose.
Yep. And there are so damn many turns in a lap, aren't there? And if you just lose like 0.05 seconds in every second or third turn, well, over the distance of 90 minutes, that'll accumulate, and at the end of the day, the Game Racer players are just that little bit faster, and they dominate the race. And I think we are now seeing them in the penultimate lap, so it should be the end of this lap, and then one more.
Yep.
And everyone... Yes. So we'll stick with Mike Simian here to finish off this race and also to finish off the season. And yes, please. Race control just tells me two laps. Yep, two laps to go. Anyway, we'll stick with Mike Simian for the time being because he didn't get much airtime tonight. There were so interesting fights all over the place. The RPM guys trying to get through, the Flying Canadian guys doing their magic moves, and well, last lap I hear now. Race control, make up your mind in the back there and don't leave me hanging out on the line here. Anyway, last lap for Mike Simian, and it's a good place to finish off another successful season for Game Racer FlatOut, and fully in control as he heads down Kemmel for the last time, going into Les Combes. And for all those of you who are interested in trivia, I need to mention this because the track was was really done in 1920. And then in 1921, they wanted to have the first race here. It was just normal streets between three villages, Francorchamps, Stavelot, and Malmedy. And Andreas, second trivia question for you tonight. Why didn't they do the first race in 1921, but only did it in 1922?
I have no idea.
Well, and that's good and true, because I didn't have any idea about this until about 2 hours ago when I read it. Only one starter turned up. They couldn't start the race because there was only one guy turning up for the start.
I should have been back in 21.
Curious.
That would have meant a real like podium for me.
Yes. Even I could have finished on the podium at Spa-Francorchamps. Could have been both of us turning up. I would still have finished on the podium.
Yep. Can you imagine, guys? Can you imagine starting the race and then blowing your engine?
Yes. Sorry. I'm sorry. I just had to mention that because it's just so funny. Nobody turns up for the first race at Spa. Only one guy. And then in 22, actually, they had a whole field. But we have a winner tonight. We have Mike Simian. He's in Blanchimont now. And he is really taking it carefully. And now I suppose he's waiting for the rest of the flat outs to catch up. Let's see.
Yep.
Here they go, very slow into the, oh yes, crawling, not towards Bethlehem, but towards the finish line. Here we have Mike Simian, we have Ben Tusting, and we have Kevin Clark in number three, and there they go. What a nice
finish.
What
a sight.
Well done, brilliant guys. You deserve it, a fantastic, absolutely fantastic win for Gameracer FlatOut and Gameracer FlatOut Club. Gameracer FlatOut wins the championship, and it's alone, poor Hannu Karesola, who is fighting to the last corner, securing position number four for the Roaring Pipes Maniacs, but it was not to be. They were beaten by a superb performance of Gameracer FlatOut tonight.
Anyway,
well done.
Hats off for both of the teams fighting for the champ tonight.
Yes,
race,
definitely. And RPM, let's not forget, they were leading the championship from race number one all the way to race number eight. So they were very, very, very close indeed. Right then, should we have the national anthem for the winners, Jose?
Yes, well, we still have cars coming into the start-finish line. In P5 is Tyler Sherlock.
I'm sorry.
P6, yeah. Daniel Beck.
And I think we have to mention Tyler Skrzypczak a little bit extra coming from the back of the grid, up to fifth. That's a brilliant one.
And we have Marcin and Mikael fighting for position 9, a very close fight right now, reaching the chicane.
Yep. Okay, let's show this very, very last fight of the season. And Mikael Haller has motor problems.
Yeah, indeed.
It's Mikael, it's not Marcin, it's Mikael. He's obviously losing speed because of that.
Oh, close. It's
10 and 9.
And here it comes.
And here goes Marcin.
Oh, they're late on the brakes.
Last overtaking maneuver of the season. Oh, poor Mikael.
It sticks? Yeah, it sticks.
Poor Mikael, it sticks. Yep. Well done, Marcin Skrzypczak, at least. And no,
and Mikael
spins. Mikael is out of the race with no.
No, he's not.
I thought he was out with a blown motor, but no, he's not. So
but he lost an extra position with Reggie Blaine.
He lost to Reggie Blaine, yep.
Ah.
But to be honest, that doesn't really matter that much anymore.
Okay, guys, so now the anthem for the winners of the race and the winners of the championship.
Extra silent.
Thank you.
Well, that was a well-deserved anthem for the Gameracer FlatOut players, because they showed us how to dominate a game, how to dominate a race at Spa tonight. And they're with me now in the broadcast room, and we have a very full room indeed, because I see on my screen here Ben Tusting is in, David Clark is in, Hannu Karesola is in, Kevin Clark is in, Mike Simian is in, Mikko Korkiakoskin is in, and also FlatOut team manager Tom Ilsbrooks is in. Good night, everybody.
Hello.
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 And as usual, let's start with position number 3. I think that was one of the Clarks. I'm not quite sure. I keep Kevin. On mixing you guys up. It was Kevin, somebody whispers to me. Kevin Clark, congratulations to you. Rather an uneventful race, wasn't it?
Yeah, pretty much. After the initial start, I had to get past a few cars, so that was exciting. But apart from that, it was a clean cut race.
Right, and then at one point or the other, you realized this was the championship. When did you realize that Marcin Skrzypczak was running into serious trouble?
Yes, I did. So I kind of backed off my pace a bit, and just to see how it was, the gap was going to catch back up to us, and I felt quite comfortable. So I just kept a nice steady pace and brought it home.
Brilliant. And in position number 2, it was Ben Tusting for the FlatOut Club. Were you supposed to be like the human shield behind Mike Simian?
Yes, that's correct. Definitely. If there was any RPM cars, I would have been there to try and stop them.
Well, within bounds.
Yeah, obviously, yeah.
And then the qualification pace of Mike Simian, we were stunned. Were you?
Well, in testing, Mike actually did a 2:10, so I thought really that was quite a slow lap from Mike. my best was a 2:11, but so I was expecting Mike to go quick, to be honest.
Yep, and that leads us to Mike Simian, an absolutely dominating performance tonight. You must be quite proud of yourself.
Yeah, well, I'm proud of myself, proud of the whole team, really. I can't tell you how nervous I was at the start of the race. For qualifying, my legs were jittering all over the place. So I dropped a bit of pace, but managed to get there just about into the 11. So I was happy with that, and to see the gap that I had was really chuff.
Right, so congratulations to FlatOut. Tom Ilsbrooks, did you expect your team to win after like round 6 or 7 when you were really down to the Roaring Pipes Maniacs?
Yeah, I had my faith in the guys. It can go up, can go down, and it went nice. So perfect job.
Yeah, perfect timing to win the championship basically at the end of the season. Well done indeed. Hannu Karesola for the Roaring Pipes Maniacs. How did you feel when you saw Marcin crashing really badly somewhere in your rearview mirror?
Well, it wasn't fun to see that, but at that point we already knew we can't do anything today, because the shock was amazing when we saw the Mike's qualifying lap. Yeah.
So really, the championship was basically lost after qualifying.
Yeah. Well, we tried to drive as good as we can, but there was a big difference in setup. They were so much faster on straights, and also could keep it going well in corners, so we couldn't overtake anyone even from slipstream. So.
Oh dear. Well, you did the best you could, and you ended up second in the championship, so big congratulations to the Roaring Pipes Maniacs, and you gave us a huge fight all through the season, and you were very consistent.
Yeah, it's consistency. It's been our strong point through the season. But then there was better team, and congratulations to Team FlatOut. Very well deserved win.
Thanks, Hannu.
Seeing this race.
Yeah, well done to everyone at RPM as well. It was a great battle all season, and I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I'm sure we will see.
Yeah, next
season. Next race.
Yes, GT Pros, I think, hopefully.
Yeah, it will be tough again.
Yes, and your two teams will be the last to pick the car, so better start looking for which car will be left over there at the end of the picking season, which I suppose will be end of August or beginning of September. We'll keep you all updated on that. Right now, it's the end of the season, so a very, very, very big thank you to David Garcia and Jose Estrada, who make it all happen.
Yeah, thanks guys. Thanks to STC, everyone there. Thank you very much for your effort.
Yes,
yeah,
I want
to... again.
Thanks guys, but I want to especially thank David, because, well, he is always have the time and the will to make this competition go forward and have a new season every 6 months. So I really want to thank him.
Well, yep. I really want to thank myself for having No, seriously, guys. I really want to thank my colleagues at the staff. It's not only up to me, it's up to Andreas, up to Jose, up to Eckhart, of course, even up to Christer and up to Michael as well. They put their little notes on the staff as well. And especially thanks for the teams. I am becoming more and more confident every day with all the team, with all the team spokesmen, and I think this is the key of the success for STC. The combination of the teams with big skills, big drivers, fast drivers, and a big spirit as well. And also want to thank Ben Tusting for his spokes.
Yep, I think that really nicely sums up the season. What better way to go than with a big smile. See you all then for the next Black Cup in, I suppose, end of September, beginning of October. We'll keep you all updated. There'll be test races in August. Obviously, we'll test a new qualification system. We'll test the new cars. We'll test the new skins. And then we'll be all set and ready for a new season. Bye-bye till then. And see you. This is Eckhard von Glan from Germany, your friendly voice, finishing another great season at the Sim Racing Team Challenge. Bye-bye.